Hui.
And welcome to Aloha Authentic. I'm your host, Kamaka Pili. On today's show, we're here at Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau to learn about its role in old Hawaii, but also today. Interesting fact, dramatic changes came to ancient society with the arrival of Captain Cook. Native Hawaiians treated him as a god because they thought from a distance his ship resembled the imagery of the Hawaiian god Lono. Did you know? Now you do. He's a park guide here at Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau. We have Kahakaʻio Ravenscraft joining us today. Thank you very much, man, for taking time. Before we get into that conversation, we have our protocol. Our umeke, our bowl of poi, is open on the table because Tutu used to always say, when the bowl of poi is open on the dinner table, we don't speak anything negative. It's only these words of positivity and aloha. And that's what you'll be getting here on this episode of Aloha Authentic, talking about this beautiful space called Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau. So, Kahakaʻio, what is, if we were to translate Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau, what does that mean?
Very good words. Puʻu. Yeah, Puʻu is a hill. Yeah, that's why you see Puʻu all over place names. Yeah, so Puʻu is hill. And Honua is our earth. Yeah, the earth as we know it. But when you put it together, yeah, Puʻuhonua is actually the action of expanding your own perception of the world. Yeah, that's why we call these places sanctuary, or places of refuge, because they're safe places where the individual can go through that process of gaining understanding, gaining insight. So they talk about place of refuge. For many years down here at the park, we talk about Puʻuhonua as the place of refuge, the city of refuge. We even used to call the park that, city of refuge, before we brought the Hawaiian language back in. Focusing on the law breakers, the kapu breakers, fleeing for sanctuary to preserve their lives. And while that's very true, for us today, a bigger part of it is trying to understand Puʻuhonua as that process of expanding yourself, expanding your own understanding, today we use the term consciousness a lot, yeah? And that's community consciousness, yeah? Being able to recognize your value, our value to one another. So Puʻuhonua, as a place of refuge, is a place for expanding consciousness, expanding perception, and becoming part of a community once again. You know, after going through strict trials, turmoil, tumultuous times, we say hulihia. So when an individual goes through hulihia and experiences trauma, that can make it very hard to be a part of a community and to find aloha for one another.
And then Hōnaunau is this place.
Hōnaunau is, would be the region, the Ahupua'a, the place we're located in.
So then what is, I hear this is dedicated to the god Lono. And so who does, what does he represent? Who is Lono?
Lono is, for Hawaiians, the Akua, the different gods, they are both ancestors. They are elementals, they're elemental forms. And in that sense, they're personifications of elemental forms. So Lono, when Hawaiians talk about Lono, Lono is everything from the surface of the sea, the surface of the land, up into the limits of the stratosphere. He's associated with oxygen, with wind, the winds that drive the clouds in and bring us rain. Lono is associated even with heat and fire. Kind of these different sources of life, basically. So Lono takes a number of different personifications. Lono Wikamakahiki is a very famous one that we recognize in our cultural practices today. Yeah. If you look behind us at the Haleokeawe site, that's off in the distance. Each of those statues is named after a personification of Lono. Yeah, Lono Ikaʻuali'i tells us about the Hoʻailona, the signs that our chiefs would look for to give them wisdom and guidance. Lono Ikiaveave Aloha is a form of Lono that teaches compassion and understanding. Lono Kinaʻu is a very important one in Puʻuhonua, because kina'u is the process of identifying defects. And the reason you identify defects is to make adjustments so you can correct and you can heal those things.
And that's exactly what this place does, it seems like.
Yeah, exactly. It's a healing place.
One thing I hear is just a lot of names. Mm. So then how important are names and what do they share?
Yeah, oh, names. Names.
We only have a couple minutes. I know that's a whole other episode.
Yeah, that's
but,
a whole.
But there is importance to a name.
You know, the name tells you everything about the place. Yeah. Right off to the side here, everyone calls it Two Step. And I always, you know, you gotta have aloha. But I always tell people, okay, Two Step is fine, but remember what it was called before. Yeah, that is Kapuvai. Yeah, and why is the place called Kapuvai? Because you protected a source of drinking water. Yeah, vai is the water that we drink that sustains life. Yeah, Puʻuhonua ʻōhonaunau is a sentence describing this place, the place of refuge at Hōnaunau, but its name is Ālealea. And Ālealea is the same star that we call Hokulea, which is our navigation star. And navigation stars, it all helps us with timekeeping and with managing our practices, yeah? Whether it's the practice of navigation, canoe building, healing, cultivation, whatever it is, yeah? This place provided guidance and insight for those things to happen.
Well, that's kind of a perfect segue because coming up after the break, we're gonna keep speaking with Kahakaʻio and he's gonna be sharing us, speaking of healing, how this place really does contribute in that element of healing. So that's coming up right here on Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic and welcome back here on Hawaii Island at Puʻuhonua ʻōhonaunau. We learned what a Puʻuhonua is, but now we're gonna learn how it was used. So Kahakaʻio, what would someone be running away from for them to try to get to a Puʻuhonua?
In old Hawaii, the system of managing the land, the system of law, was called kapu. And kapu were very important because they regulated our use of our resources, our interactions with one another, our relationship with each other and with the land. And so for that reason, these kapu were considered very sacred, but they were very severe. Yeah, to violate a kapu was basically an act of going against the community. So a kapu breaker would either be expelled completely from their community and oftentimes could be put to death. The Puʻuhonua was a place created by our ali'i, by our chiefs, to provide that refuge so that kapu breakers could be reintegrated into the society. The idea was that every individual person has a sense of value. Yeah, they have a kuleana, a responsibility that helps the society thrive. So the Puʻuhonua would be a physical place where blood could not be spilt. This allowed that kapu breaker to sometimes they had to flee for their life. It could be very dramatic. And they would literally flee for their life. But upon arriving at a Puʻuhonua, they would find that sanctuary. Yeah, they would be protected. And a process could occur. This usually involved different types of kahuna. Yeah, and kahuna were experts in certain arts. In the case of Puʻuhonua, these were experts in healing, in spirituality, yeah, helping that person reconcile, with their own decisions, with their own actions, and helping facilitate a way for that person to reintegrate into society. Yeah, the Puʻuhonua were not meant to be places of exile, yeah, so we don't want to think of it as like a prison. It's really a site for rehabilitation. And the goal of Puʻuhonua is to see that individual return to a community with a sense of kuleana. And for Hawaiians, kuleana is, responsibility, yes. But it's also honor and privilege, yeah? So it gives you kind of a reason for living, a reason to do the work that you do. And it's really on that understanding that every single person has that value. Whether you're a farmer, a fisherman, a canoe builder, a medicine woman, a medicine man, a warrior, doesn't matter what you do is of value. to your people. And so Puʻuhonua is there to foster that sense of value, to cultivate it. And yeah, basically think of it as taking someone at the lowest of their low, the lowest of the low, and you're gonna elevate them so they can come back and have a part in society. I think that's part of the beauty of
I was just gonna say, that's beautiful. But with that being said, how challenging was it to get to a Puʻuhonua?
In some cases, it could be very challenging, absolutely. You know, our Puʻuhonua here, if you kind of can see the grounds, you can see that it's isolated, it's surrounded by water. Hawaiʻi Island, we're surrounded by lava rock. So just the environment could cause that to be a little bit treacherous. You know, if it's a situation where a person is being pursued, you know, perhaps the warriors of the chief are trying to grab that person, apprehend them. So it definitely had its challenges. And I think it, by design, it wasn't meant to just be easy. Yeah,
It was meant to be challenging.
Wow. You know, to test that person and see if they have the willpower, the strength, the intelligence, the akamai to make that happen, to prove that, I'm a person of value and you will see that value. I just have to make it to that Puʻuhonua to do those things, yeah.
So once then they go through this rehabilitation per se, and then they ha'alele, they leave and they go back into society and their community. Mm-hmm. Is there kind of like a universal understanding and like this, how would you say it, like a honor system per se, that maybe the person who was chasing that person who came, who was trying to get here, once they leave, they already knew, like, I'm not chasing you anymore. Was that like just an understanding that everybody had that honor system?
Yeah, I believe so. I truly believe so. Puʻuhonua were you know, so important in the society because of that role that they played. When I do research, when I look at mo'olelo, you know, it seems like anytime someone made it to a Puʻuhonua, it was almost like a celebrated thing. It was almost a way of exalting that individual, even though they were a criminal, they were at rock bottom. But it seems that just the act of arriving at a Puʻuhonua and being able to experience that, was kind of this sense of, you had this honor system, this understanding. And even during times of war, Puʻuhonua were used as well, just to keep people safe. And this seems to be something that is honored, when I look at our history. During times of war in Hawaii, Puʻuhonua, usually are not touched. And when they are, there are a few examples where this did happen, where warriors attacked a Puʻuhonua. That was considered, something very heva for those warriors to do, that they should not have caused that action. They should not have shed blood in these places. So I think it is something that was taken very seriously.
In just a couple sentences, your response I'm sure can go longer, but do you think this kind of a concept could be in today's world?
I think it's very important in today's world, and how it would function, that's a lot of, there's a lot of questions to that. But just the whole process of, again, taking our criminals, taking people that are at rock bottom, the lowest of the low, and fostering that sense of value, fostering them to be able to say, okay, what are your talents? What are your skills? How can you contribute, to your people, to your community? And fostering that sense of belonging, I think, is very important too.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And actually, stick around, because coming up after the break, we will elaborate more on that and how Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau has a place in society today. That's coming up right after the break. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic again. We're here at the beautiful Puʻuhonua o Hōnaunau, where we're going over what purpose it served in old Hawaii, but what about today? How can we learn from this today? So again, Kahakaʻio, thank you very much, man, for your time. Sacred place, would this be considered a sacred space today?
Absolutely. Wahipana, it's a sacred place.
So then when we look around, this is now a national park, and there's a few in Hawaii, this being one of them, but that then becomes a more of a visitor destination for our tourists. Mm-hmm. What do they walk away with, or is that an issue?
It is a matter that requires a lot of balance, for us, being a descendant of the area, carrying on old traditions, but also being, a park guide, a park ranger. So in a lot of senses, I am here for the visitors, but it's really an opportunity to portray, to kind of paint the picture of who we are. you know, as Kanaka Maoli, as Native Hawaiians, as caretakers and stewards of this wahipana, this sacred place. Yeah, and wahipana is a place with a pulse, and it's the people that bring that pulse. So being a national park today is our opportunity to share mo'olelo, to write our own narratives, you know, to dictate our own history, and how we see ourselves in the world, how we see ourselves in the middle of this Pacific Ocean. You know, and the ocean is not a distance for us that separates. Yeah, it's actually that very thing that links us to one another, to our ancestors, and to the rest of the world. So when people come here, you know, and they enter in this sacred space, part of our kuleana is to help show these people how to conduct yourselves. Yeah, you're walking in a place of chiefs. So it's on us to share these mo'olelo and to teach people how to enter a sacred space, and how to learn from these places. So mo'olelo, sharing traditions, you know, sharing ancestral knowledge, is a very big part of how we engage and how we interact with our visitors that are coming from, yeah, all over this world.
Is this the only Puʻuhonua? Were there more across the islands?
Oh yeah, there are actually many. Yeah, I can think of many, even just on Hawaiʻi Island. Most heiau, you know, our Hawaiian temples, most heiau included areas that were used as Puʻuhonua. So, you know, we have Hōnaunau, in Kealakekua we have one, Hikiau. There are many throughout Kailua Kona. Even Puʻukohola itself, remembered as a war temple, but it also had an area used as Puʻuhonua. And across the islands, yeah, Kauiki in Hanamaui was a Puʻuhonua. And I learned a story from Oahu, which talked about a high chiefess named Kalaʻi Manuʻia. And the chiefess herself was actually a Puʻuhonua. So it wasn't even just like a location, yeah, just being in her presence. And I learned this story. She lived in the district of Ewa. And at one point, her warriors apprehended a pig thief, a man who had snuck into her kauhale, you know, snuck into her dwelling, her stables, and he stole a bunch of pigs. And of course, the warriors caught him and they grabbed him. And, you know, they bring him before the chief and they're ready to take off his head. Yeah, this, hey, he's a kapu breaker. And she proclaims that, oh no, in my presence, this is a Puʻuhonua. You cannot spill his blood. But we need to teach him a lesson. Yeah, we need to foster that sense of kuleana. So she says, because you have a fondness for my pigs, I now place you as my royal stable master. Your kuleana is to take care of all my pigs. Yeah, and that was really a form of elevating him, yeah, because he was just, you know, kind of a farmer, yeah. Now he is in charge of something bigger. And lucky for the guy, he was able to rise to that occasion, and he lives out his life as the caretaker of all the pua in the district of Ewa. So kind of I think that's a cool story that really illustrates, you know, what Puʻuhonua is. But yeah, coming back to Hōnaunau, that concept of Puʻuhonua, I think, is something that still remains, you know, in our communities today. And creating that safe place, you know, to do the inner work, yeah, to heal trauma, to discover, you know, your sense of value, what your talents are, and how to bring those forward to your community. And I see Puʻuhonua existing in modern times as well. And a good example is Puʻuhonua o Puʻuhuluhulu, which was created truly through an act of protest. We can't deny that. But this protest was done to protect something sacred. And if you're going to protect something sacred, you must learn how to conduct yourself in a sacred way. Yeah, the process has changed, you know, how it looks has changed. But the foundational wisdom, the ancestral wisdom, still remains.
The main thing I'm hearing about this and all those other, and even that mo'olelo you shared, was kind of grasping on this and sharing that aloha to share that love. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, you mentioned you're a descendant here. Mm. Doing the work that you do, what then is aloha to you?
Mm. Yeah, aloha, you know, for me, aloha is a very profound sense of acknowledgement. And it's also a profound sense of authenticity, which is perfect because this program is called Aloha Authentic. And I think, you know, we often think of aloha as just, oh, kind of compassion, giving. But sometimes being authentic means you have to give the hard love. And so it's being true to yourself, to your beliefs. And it's sitting, you know, aloha is sitting, he alo a he alo, sitting face to face. Maybe we don't have to agree, but at least we recognize each other. At least we try to foster this sense of understanding, this sense of truly acknowledging the presence of each other. Yeah, because when you share aloha, you know, you're sharing a single breath. Yeah, and breath is one of those sources of life. So you're sharing a single source of life. You're present in that moment, in time, in space. Anyway, we can get philosophical and talk about aloha for hours.
We'll come back for a part two on this.
But yeah, to me, aloha is authenticity and acknowledgement.
That's beautiful, bro. Mahalo nui. You know, the bigger message out of this is share your aloha with your neighbor and everybody else today. Stick around, we'll be right back on Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. And Kahakaʻio, thank you very much, man. This was super educational. I'm hoping that the viewers are inspired to find out more and maybe even plan the trip here. So if they want to do that, is there a website they can go and find out more at?
Absolutely. Yeah, the park has its official website, www.nps.gov/puho, which is P-U-H-O. And on the website, you'll find articles, discussions of history, and guides to help plan your visit. I believe we even have a virtual tour right now. So yeah, a lot of good material to check out online.
Awesome. Well, it's not the same value of the knowledge you shared, but it's a little makana we can thank you with. This was so cool. Bring our attention to our featured artist for this episode. We're going back to Oahu to a company called Lily Ray Clay, a mother-owned business specializing in small-batch, uniquely handcrafted polymer clay earrings. Be sure to follow her on her Instagram page. And if you aren't already doing so, be sure to follow us on Instagram and Facebook at Aloha Authentic. Until next time, aloha, ahui ho.